Good morning. Welcome to Center for Spiritual Living. Listen to my daddy preach. He would read the holy word, consecrate the holy bread. Everyone would kneel and bow. Today the only difference is everything is holy now. Everything, everything, everything is holy now. When I was in Sunday school, we would learn about the time Moses split the sea in two. Jesus made the water wine. I remember feeling sad. Miracles don't happen still. But now I can't keep track, 'cause everything's a miracle. Everything, everything, everything's a miracle. Everything is holy now. 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 And wine from water is not so small. An even better magic trick is that there's anything is here at all. And so the challenging thing becomes not to look for miracles, finding where there isn't one. Holy water was rare at best. I could barely wet my fingertips. Now I have to hold my breath, like I'm drowning in a sea of it. There used to be a world out there, heaven's second rate hand-me-down. Now I'm walking with a reverend air, 'cause everything is holy now. 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 And wine from water is not so small. An even better magic trick is that anything is here at all. And so the challenging thing becomes not to look for miracles, but finding where there isn't one. This morning outside I stood, saw a little red-winged bird shining like a burning bush, singing like a scripture verse. Made me want to bow my head. I remember when church let out. Today the only difference is everything is holy now. 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 Everything is holy now.
Justin Vogel, our music director, religious science practitioner, all-around good guy. Good morning. Hey, Joe, look. He comes over and he goes, if you see my phone on stage anywhere, it's mine. Tell me about it. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to introduce you to Joe Blom. He's behind the closed wall most of the time. He's an absolute genius. One of the most talented and generous guys around, and so, yeah, amen. Well, once again, good morning. Welcome to Center for Spiritual Living, Greater Las Vegas, where it, maybe especially today, is a perfect day in paradise. Isn't it gorgeous? I mean, we had to go through some flooding to get to this cool moment, but it's good, it's good, it's very good. And you are in a community that believes that God is all there is. The energy that created the universe in the beginning, it's still the only energy there is. The energy of God is who you are, is who I am, is who we are as a community. And the face that you look at today, any face that you look at, is the face of God. So we welcome you into this place where we are each awakening to our spiritual magnificence. We are helping to create a world that works for everyone. We have a magnificent morning and a wonderful afternoon in store for you this day. And we're so glad that you are here today. If you're here for the very first time, you are absolutely welcome at this stop on your journey of faith. I trust that something this morning will touch you and spark that spirit that is reawakening in your conscious mind, and it will be very important in your spiritual journey, and you are absolutely welcome here this morning. We have a welcome center in the lobby when our service ends today. If you go to that welcome center, a wonderful group of people would love to meet you and talk with you. They can answer questions. There's a gift for you that they have to give you there. It's something that you can read, hear a little bit more about what we believe and the faith principles that we follow. It might help explain why you feel a connection, maybe even already. But just settle in. Throughout the morning, we have songs that we sing. The words are going to be on the screen. You have a connection card in your program. That card is your way to let us know, first of all, that you are here. If you're here regularly, that's great. Welcome, welcome, welcome. If you're here for the first time, let us know some more about you so we can help each other stay connected. The back of the card is where you can make agreements with yourself, sign up for things, let us know a prayer request, that kind of thing. Those connection cards are important, and they come in with the offering later on in our service. But all of that said, I want to welcome everyone here to this magnificent morning. We're going to sing. That's the first thing we usually do together. If and as you are able, will you please stand? We're going to sing about something that is the truth, that we are one. Because God is all there is, that's all that we are, and we are one people. That's all there is to the song. It's a wonderful, simple thing, and it goes like this.
One people living on one planet, joining in one family.
beautiful. Spend a couple minutes, shake a hand, get a hug, introduce yourself to the people around you.
Good morning. As we move into this morning's contemplation time, please check your cell phones, silence them. Thank you. So let's begin this week's affirmation from your program. Now, these are nice and handy. You might choose to cut it out and read it out loud often, this week especially, to remind you of the truth of your being. Today, I remember who I am, a perfect and unique expression of the infinite, life-giving energy of the divine. Now take a deep breath and let the music take us into a silent place, followed by this morning's invocation.
Let God love me. To be still, let God love me.
When this old world starts to push and shove me, I need to be still and let God love me. I need to relax. Let God take over. I need to relax. Let God take over.
And take this load off of my shoulders. I need to relax. Let God take over.
I need
to be still.
Let God love me.
I need to be still. Let God love me. When this old world starts to push and shove me, to be still and let God love me. I need to be still and let God love me.
As I continue to be still and let God love me, I open my heart to the presence of the infinite, the presence of God. For in this moment is absolute, eternal, unconditional love that is God. This profound love is the source of all life. This love is the source of my life. This love is the givingness of God, the givingness of grace. It is right here, right now, permeating every atom, every thought, every being. I am awed and inspired, knowing that I am truly one with this magnificence, one with God, one with all. And I am so grateful for my awareness in this moment of grace, the givingness of grace, the grace of God that moves, that lives, and expresses through me. I'm grateful for this time of connection, connection with spirit in a greater way, this time of connecting with each other, this time of expansion, expanding my awareness of love, of peace, of joy, of wisdom, of grace. And I bless this service and everyone connected in any way, whether in this room or watching it online. I know we are creating a vibrant world, a world that works for everyone. And so it is.
Remembering who I am. morning. I want to take this opportunity to say how grateful I am to be here and just how grateful I am in general. So let's take a moment and just sit and give thanks. In 2011, Reverend Doug mentioned to me that the themes of the year were going to be based from the science of mind. And in the beginning, there's a poem or a piece there called Peace Be Unto Thee, Stranger. And so I thought, you know what, how cool would it be to write 12 songs and call the record Peace Be Unto Thee, Stranger, and put an album together. Which I did. I never recorded it, but I wrote it. So anyway, I'm going to read this to you. I'm going to actually read this entire first page of The Science of Mind, and then the song's called Peace Be Unto Thee, Stranger. These lessons are dedicated to that truth which frees man from himself and sets him on the pathway of a new experience, which enables him to see through the mist to the eternal and changeless reality. Peace be unto thee, stranger. Peace be unto thee, stranger. Enter and be not afraid. I have left the gate open, and thou art welcome to my home. There is room in my house for all. I have swept the hearth and lighted the fire. The room is warm and cheerful, and you will find comfort and rest within. The table is laid, and the fruits of life are spread before thee. The wine is here also. It sparkles in the light. I have set a chair for you where the sunbeams dance through the shade. Sit and rest and refresh your soul. Eat of the fruit and drink the wine. All is yours, and you are welcome. Peace be unto thee, stranger. We are on this journey as one, sharing the gifts we have been given, living in unity and love. Peace be unto thee, stranger. I come to you as truth and harmony, open to the path that's not yet written, embracing life eternally. I wish you peace, I give you love, one with spirit and one in mind. I wish you peace, I give you love, grounded in perspective, convicted divine. Peace be unto thee, stranger. I see the doors of wisdom in your mind, passing through the crest of your condition, limiting beliefs are left behind. Peace be unto thee, stranger, omnipotent and present with the one, breaking through the barriers of bondage. Freedom stems within, steeping love.
wish you peace. I give you love, standing in spirit and embracing truth. I give you peace. I give you love, glory and love fill my soul. Peace be unto thee, stranger. We are joined through spirit, love and truth. Open to the future, not yet written. One with spirit, we are love. One with spirit, we are love. One with spirit, we are love.
Beautiful. Thank you. I actually heard that before. You have sung it for me before, and it's nice to hear it again. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. So Justin gave thanks before he started that, and he didn't know that that was going to be a large part of what I was going to talk about because I didn't tell him. So he didn't know it up here, but what was that he said at the end? We are one, I think, something like that. Yeah, yeah. So we have an opportunity. Well, we have an opportunity every day to fall into grace. But one of the things that we've been doing as a community this year is something called going deeper together. What does that mean? It means going deeper into this thing called life, going deeper into our contact with, our understanding of, and our connection with the divine. And sometimes going deeper together, going deeper into the bliss, also means going deeper into something else that's a part of that excavation of what we've covered up for the rest of our, you know, for much of our lives. And so that happens too, but it's all part of the uncovering of what already lives inside each one of us, the presence of God, the awareness of connection with that infinite one. It's a part of everything that is, and it's who we are, and we have an opportunity today, and frankly, we have this opportunity every day to fall into bliss and to fall into grace and to understand what that can mean. And to understand that it is actually a natural occurrence when we practice spiritual living. And how can we do it more consistently or more frequently? How can we have those experiences? So when I say grace, when we talk about grace in this faith, what does it mean? Do you have a concept of grace for yourself in your life? It's okay to nod or say yes or think about it. It's up to you, but do you have an idea of grace? What is grace? And I'm not talking about the thing that we say before we have a meal. It's more than that. What is grace to you? From a more traditional religious perspective, grace is understood as something that God bestows, right? Like it's sort of something God chooses to do randomly, perhaps. In this faith, we have a different understanding of that, right? We believe that grace is a quality of God. Therefore, grace is something that God simply is. God can't help it. God can't not be and express grace. So there is that. But we have these experiences as we live consciously and spiritually through our lives. We have these experiences that sometimes defy words, right? You know it when you experience it. And yet you don't really have a way to define it in words. I found a piece by Carolyn Mace in a book that she wrote called Invisible Acts of Power. And for me, this actually works really, really well because it bridges my understanding of grace as something that simply God is with a more personal application. So she says this in Invisible Acts of Power. And she has had her own evolution on this as well. She said, when teaching about health and human consciousness, until now, I have often defined grace as a universal life force, but now I find that to be inadequate. Life force simply is. Well, that's true. God is. Grace is. It is a neutral, undirected energy that surrounds us and supports the vitality of all beings. So she's calling that life force. She says, grace, on the other hand, has a spiritual quality. It is energy infused with a force greater than our own, a divine intention. When it arrives, usually unannounced or unrequested, out of the blue, she has out of the blue in quotes, she said, it fills you with a luminous awareness that is different from everyday consciousness. It makes you come alive with vision and determination and the strength to act. Grace is also the organizing force behind coincidences, the synchronistic experiences in our lives that some consider chance, but that are definitely not random. Grace illuminates your path by moving through your intuition, influencing the choices that you make. It is a power that works hand in hand with your intuition to guide actions in the right direction, the direction that will do the most good. So there's a whole lot in that concept of grace. First of all, that it is an aspect of the life force that just is. It's neutral and undirected. But that it is also infused with divine intention. Well, what is divine intention? The will of God toward good. And what she says is that it can only be experienced through our own consciousness. She calls it intuition, through our own intuition. Intuition being the mind of God within each one of us, the voice of God within us. So the idea of grace as an experience is there, but it's an experience that can only happen through an awakened consciousness, through a consciousness that is in touch with its own higher wisdom, that is available to that intuition so that it may guide, lead, direct us in the direction of greater good for ourselves and for the world. That's the idea of God is not bestowing it. God simply is that. And the divine intention, which is a desire for good and more good, a tendency toward that, then activates through the human consciousness, through the human intuition, and therefore out into acts of good or the direction of greater good in our lives. And so either that experience that causes you to come alive with greater energy and passion and determination and strength to act, either that or those seeming what other people might call coincidences that are so divinely inspired that it couldn't happen any other way than through the divine. How many have had those experiences lately? Anything like that? Yeah? What did you feel like? Go ahead and just call out what you felt like in those moments. Calm. Inspired. What was back there? Energized. Inspired. Warm. Happy. Embraced. Supported. Lifted. Confident. Clear. These kind of things can happen. That's the idea, that when that's activated, it causes us to feel more alive, to come alive in a way that is enthusiastic and passionate. It gives us determination, courage, the will to act. Those kinds of things happen. Well, many of you know that we're having an event later today that is geared around a concept of awakening humanity to its spiritual magnificence, of helping to create a world that works for everyone, of partnering with others both locally and internationally to have this experience happen. Well, we're excited to have Reverend Connie Phelps with us in our midst today. She's going to share with us at the luncheon, but I asked her to share some time with you here this morning as well, because she is definitely somebody who has had that experience of coming alive in a way that is, for me, terrifying when I think about it, and for her it is something that I suspect is something that she simply can't help, because it is it's terrifying. Okay, great. So anyway, she is the spiritual director, the founding visionary in the Kenya Center for Spiritual Living in Nairobi, Kenya, and she and her husband Patrick are here today. We're all going to head out to the ministers' conference this week, but she's here, and I want her to share with you this idea of falling into grace, because I suspect she's had several experiences. Let's welcome Connie Phelps.
And here's one of those moments of coincidence. We match. That I have in Africa. They know that we're here today, and I got an email this morning, and they said, please greet them for us. So greetings from the students there. If you ever have a moment of wondering about the support that you give from this center and wonder what a difference that you're doing in the world, I'm here to tell you that your support of the work that we are doing in Africa, your support allows me to be there to do the work that I do in Africa in the way of transforming consciousness and making this a world that works for everyone. And it is, without your support, that wouldn't be happening. So I really want you to know the difference that you make. Does anybody here want anything to be different in their life? Anybody? Is there, it doesn't have to be a big thing. Okay, well, I think that's universal. I think that's absolutely universal. We all want things to be different. But here's one of the things that I'm beginning to understand at a deeper level, is that for many of us, we want things to be different, but we don't want to change. We want it to be different out there in our lives. But what I know to be absolutely true is for anything to have any lasting difference out there, we have to change. So what I've realized about that, of working with the people that I'm working with in Kenya, Africa, is that they don't just want things to be different. They want life to be different. And they really, really, really want it to be different. And I've just, it's been this humbling, opening experience working with them, because they have been living for centuries in absolute poverty and limitation. Now, you take any idea of limitation that we might have in our lives and multiply that by the nth degree, and you have a sense of what most of the people there experience in their lives on a daily basis. They are in such a place of survival that, quite frankly, when I first went there, I thought, what on earth am I doing in this country? But what I've come to realize is they want it so badly that they are willing to do whatever they need to do in order to have the change that they know is possible. And through our teaching, they're beginning to get that. They're beginning to grasp that. They're beginning to really understand, and the manifestations that they have been having in such a short period is nothing less than miraculous. It's awe-inspiring to witness the transformations of consciousness that are happening. I want to share one brief story about that. One of my students, and here's something that's really fascinating. I have 8 students over there, 7 of them are men. So I just offer that because everybody says our churches are filled with women. Well, apparently not. We're going to change that. Anyway, one of my students is a fundamental Christian minister. And the first day he came to class, he came to a discovery class, and it was a day in class when we were talking about the big things that we believe in religious science. Like, what do we believe about God? What do we believe about heaven? What do we believe about hell? What do we believe about sin? It was those, answering those big questions. And this man was sitting there, and it was like, he's asking me these questions, and at the end of it, he said to me, "Are you telling me they lied?" Alrighty. So I said, "Well, here's what I know. They're not lying. They're only imparting to you what they believe to be true." Because isn't that true of all of us? We're only being everything that we've ever learned. So it's not that they were lying to you. They were giving you your truth. And all I've got to offer you is what I believe to be true, what we teach. You can take it or leave it. You can believe it or not believe it. But I invite you to explore that. 2 weeks ago, because I teach a class on Sunday mornings in Nairobi from Canada. Isn't that technology just incredibly amazing that I can teach a class in Africa? That's just, it thrills me. Anyway, so I'm teaching class the other morning, and this man, his name is Ben, and he said to me, I want to tell you about an experience I had this week. He said, I went out to my Bible study class that I teach, and I went to start explaining something, and I couldn't. I couldn't. He couldn't speak those words anymore. Have you ever had that experience where something that you used to believe so firmly that this is the way it is, and all of a sudden you realize you don't believe that anymore? So he said he went home, and this man has only been in class for about 12 weeks of classes. That's it. And he said to me, so I went home, and I had to sit down and take everything that I taught and try to put it in a way that I could speak about it in terms with his belief that it is now. Truly, truly remarkable. Just amazes me. So thank you all for the support that you give and the opportunity, and we're just so grateful to be here and to share and to just be in love with all of you. So thank you, and thank you for having me.
There is so much living spirit in this woman, can you tell? And in the work and in the awakening that's happening, and I know that words are inadequate to give us actually the felt sense of the degree of poverty and the history of it, right? And so we talk about our lives and we whine about our problems, and many of you know Margaret Owens, vocalist and wonderful New Thought musician, and she and her husband have this kind of, it's a little bit sarcastic, but it's also kind of bitingly true that when we start doing this, we have to now call them first world problems, right? These are our first world issues, and they are really as nothing compared to what most of the people in the world have to live with. And yet, it's not to diminish them in any way, because anything that inhibits our own experience of life is a concern for us. And whether we are attempting to come away from centuries of one mindset into something completely foreign and totally new, or something that we have kind of felt all of our lives and just want to awaken more to, that's our journey. And how blessed we are to have a journey like that instead of what some other people have to do, right? And so I want to share with you some experiences that we are experiencing together of falling into grace, of having those luminous moments that awaken something in us and cause us to feel more alive. I'm going to go back about a year. A lot of you were here a year ago. A year ago was the time when we were becoming aware of all of the, well, I encapsulated it by calling it the roof drama. Anyone remember this? Oh, yeah. So about a year ago, we were becoming aware of the extent of the repairs and the cost of the repairs to this A-frame roof on the outside, to the roof above our great room and offices, to the walkway outside the upstairs classrooms. We were becoming aware that this was not something that was going to be, a $20 Elmer's glue job. And first experience of grace was one Sunday when I spoke to that, not concern, but to that condition. Said, here's what it is. Well, many people in this community stepped up. Something in them came alive. There was something that said, I have the courage, the willingness, and the determination to act on this, and I'm going to help support these repairs. And so that came out in all of that research and all of that seeming delay. Suddenly, this community stepped up and said, we're going to take care of our spiritual home. And it happened. And it was profound and delightful and wonderful and a terrific experience. So that was an experience of falling into grace, of just opening up to that greater support of the universe. And yes, it's not trying to drag my consciousness out of centuries of oppression or poverty. It is, however, one of our collective concerns and issues. And so we moved into it and we supported it, and it was magnificent. Doing, as Reverend Connie said, whatever it takes to achieve that new higher consciousness. And that was fabulous. And at the same time, a long envisioned, long desired project ended up being delayed once again because of those additional costs. And that project is the remodeling of this space, right? Of putting in some new seating and some new flooring into the sanctuary. So that got delayed because of those extra costs. So now we fast forward a year. We come up to about the present moment, and we have another multi-stage experience of falling into grace around that. Come up to a year later, and we've decided that, you know what, I think it's time. We had a couple of design ideas that we presented to you, to this congregation, to this community. There were two design ideas, and as a result of those presentations, there were people that came forward verbally to say, I'm committing X number of dollars to that project. And because of that initial declaration of support, which I guess I'm admitting this, was beyond my expectation. I wasn't thinking big enough at the time, but others were, thank you. Those initial promises of support allowed us to expand our idea of what's possible for this community right now and what we are ready for. So yes, we are going to be doing that. We're going to be reconfiguring this. We're going to get new chairs. Yeah. And some other new stuff in here. And we're also going to put new tables and chairs in the great room. And we're going to get some new equipment in the kitchen. And we're going to get new auditorium lighting in here. So that's exciting. And that was one of those things that just, with the 8, 10, 12 people who said, this is what I intend to give, we thought, there's a whole lot more in this community. And apparently, from that indication, we are ready for something greater. And we are so ready for something greater. So that was the first of many stages of grace experiencing in this reawakened and finally long awaited and ready now project. The second piece of that was that we have had, many of you know this, some of you don't, on Thursday, for the last 8 years, we have hosted another congregation who meets and does their celebration and worship all day Thursday, from early in the morning until mid to late afternoon on Thursday. And it's an Ethiopian congregation in the Coptic Christian tradition. And they have grown, since they have been housed here, to a congregation of between 400 and 500. And so every Thursday, our long-suffering staff of Mary and Lynn and anybody else who happened to have a meeting on Thursday morning got to be at work behind the office doors with all of these 400 to 500 people and an equal number of children, it seems sometimes, running rampant through the... and with that many people, the attendant wear and tear on our the inside, especially of our facility. This remodeling, renovation project could not have happened with them here. Well, I have news that just this past Thursday, this wonderful St. Michael's Ethiopian Orthodox congregation opened their brand new facility on Thursday. So they are moved into their new church home that they built. Yes. So we are happy for them. Mary and Lynn and I were among the honored guests on Thursday with their grand opening celebration, and it was really spectacular to see what they had manifested together. It's a beautiful building, and it's a really remarkable thing. And now we can move forward because we don't have that excessive use kind of thing going on with a different congregation. And so I'm happy to let you know that this past week, the Leadership Council, your elected representatives, authorized deposits to be placed for the new chairs and the new flooring in the sanctuary. So the project is on and we are a go. Yes. And that new part, the chairs and the flooring, will be done before Christmas. Yeah, so it was spectacular timing. It was at the very last second. Tuesday was the deadline for making the deposit for the chairs because the chairs have a 12-week lead time. 12 weeks takes us right up to about a week and a half before Christmas. And so we're going to know that because this has been in mind for so long, and truly 50 years is long enough for these chairs, yes? Yes, and they have served us very, very well for 51 years. They have been a magnificent, well, up until recently, support for for this community. And as somebody said yesterday at our practitioner meeting, for thousands and thousands and thousands of people over 51 years. So your seat and the seat that you're sitting on have had thousands of others, and it's amazing to know that it has done that, and that we are poised now to move forward for ourselves and future generations. So that was wonderful. And now, the idea of this grace-filled project itself, the actual rolling out of it, Many of you are aware that we had presented two options. Well, we presented three. The third option was pretty much almost literally shot down, so which was to reupholster these chairs. Anyway, so, so there were two options, right? There was option one and option two, and we invited you to choose which one that you liked the best, that you would support, or hopefully you would support anything, but that you were drawn to, and we just had that for a few weeks. Well, the first option had 22 votes. The second option had 28 votes. Not that far apart. It was very interesting to see that there was not a huge groundswell of this is it for either one. And so we looked at that and we were like, So we have a final design. Who won? What? Well, it's our seats. Well, it's actually more than they both won, so I'm going to share it with you. Sabrina yelled it out. Everybody won. So, you won't probably be able to see this. We'll have this over in the great room for a short time later. So what we ended up with was a hybrid. We're very green here. And so, see, green. So it's a hybrid. From option number one, the luxury vinyl flooring. From option number one, for in here, in the center of here where the chairs are in the center aisle, and out in the lobby. From option number two, this beautiful carpet, which will be around the perimeter, up on the stage, up the stairs there, and in the balcony, right? And from neither option, the navy blue chair, which you see sitting in the lobby, which many of us fell in love with just by the color and, you know, I mean, all the chairs would feel this way, but the color seemed to call to many of us as well. So everybody got something who voted. Nobody got everything except for the three who wrote on their ballot, how about the flooring from number one and the carpet from number two and the chairs that we have in, right, the chair that we have in. Three people said that. That's not why we chose it, but they got everything that they asked for. But the idea of this is, the idea of grace is a direction of greater good, is the idea that the wisdom of the many is always far greater and far more on point than the wisdom of any one person or any two people. You know, the wisdom of the many comes together to reveal a greater idea that's held in the mind of God. So this is ready to rock and roll. And if you go over to the great room before the luncheon starts, before you buy your ticket or whatever, this will be set up. We've got some information sheets. We've got pledge forms if you would like to fill it out or take it with you and bring it back to the office to give an idea of how much you can support this over and above your regular support for the next year. That would be great. But I know that because of all of the early indicators, that this is an idea whose time has definitely come. It's not been delayed. It's not been denied. It has been simply abiding for the perfect right time, which is right now. And because it is right now, we know that it's going to be a grace-filled experience. That it, yes, there is work to be done, and the greater good is the direction that we are headed. It is absolutely what is in store for us because that is the way that it works. So these ideas of falling into grace are something that can happen in our life issues, in the concerns that we have for ourselves and our relationships and our lives, for our community, for our congregation, for our buildings, for everything, every aspect of the human life experience. Grace is. It is an experience that can be enhanced and increased in our lives. How to do that? Well, there's two things that came to mind, and both of them are ones that I have had pretty powerful experiences of and examples of lately. You know, I'm talking about this year theme in this center is called Going Deeper Together. It's being indicated in so many of the groups that meet and so many of the activities that are taking place, so many of the new ministries that are developing. We had a quarterly practitioner meeting yesterday, and we sat in a big circle for most of the time, and many of the practitioners shared a practice that they have now or have had for a while of gratitude, of giving thanks. Justin gave an example of that just before he sang. The idea of starting every day or including within every day sincere gratitude, giving thanks, gratitude, grace, the GERS. The GERS are a really wonderful spiritual practice to experience grace on a more consistent basis, to invite that experience of coming alive, of those synchronistic experiences happening that no human mind could design. Give thanks, be grateful. What is it that there is to be grateful for? And I imagine, Reverend Connie, you are introducing that idea where you are as well, because no matter what, and that's easier for me to say here than it might be for somebody in another country, in another situation, and it is a universal truth that there is great good everywhere. And that idea of recognizing it and of giving thanks for it is incredibly conducive to those greater experiences of grace. If you want to grease your consciousness for grace, give gratitude. You know, give thanks. Be grateful. Find something to be grateful for. Somebody called it a rampage of gratitude, which I loved, right? And so that idea. And then another thing would be to affirm within yourself, God's grace is my sufficiency through me. Remind yourself that it can only happen through you. God doesn't bestow grace upon you. It doesn't come from the outside. It has to come from the inside. So yes, God's grace is my sufficiency. It's sufficient for me unto all things, but it has to happen through me. As Carolyn May said, through intuition, through that connection with Spirit. But that is absolutely the truth. Grace is energy, as Carolyn May said. It is the life force. It is everywhere present. It is energy infused with divine intention. And again, what is divine intention? What is the divine intention toward good? Leading and guiding us toward good. Or if you're like me, in a lot of cases, pushing. While I resist with everything I've got, pushing me into my greater good. Whatever it takes, it's going in the direction of good. So I come up with this idea. I don't come up with this idea. I just subscribe to it now. Why resist it? So what if it's scary? So what if it's scary? God's got my back. God's got your back. Fall into grace. It's so good. It's so good. And so it is. Namaste. All right. Yeah. All right. So I'm going to move this because we're going to have some fun stuff up here in just a minute. But you'll see this over in the great room. And we're going to move into a time to share now of our financial supply. God is. Grace is. Life is. Good is. God is all there is. And God is everything. Everything that is in form. Everything that is in potential. And we bring ourselves to this place in our spiritual practice where we understand that the substance of God, that is everything visible, is infinite. It is limitless. And this thing that we call money, whether it's something that you're giving today in cash or a check, if you're something that you do automatically through an auto-tithe program, or you go to the bookstore and contribute through your credit card with extra miles, or you give in some other way to this center. The substance that you're giving is a part of the substance of the divine. It is divine in origin, and therefore it is infinite in possibility. I invite you to give this day with an attitude of gratitude, with a willingness to open to that divine influx, to be led to your higher and greater good, and that includes your higher and greater experience of the financial supply of the universe. So however you choose to give this morning, I want to thank you in advance for the work that this center does for you and for all who are drawn here. And we give 10% of what you give this morning. We give 10% of all of that to our denomination, which does work globally help to spread this idea in a global way. So as you give this morning, know that this is God in action and that it has a global reach. Let's give a silent blessing before we say an affirmation together. And then please say after me, I give thanks for the increasing abundant good in all areas of my life now.
In all areas of my life now.
And so it is.
And so it is.
Something's calling me. Something's calling me. Something's calling me a little bit deeper than I am.
never been before. Feels like I'm walking on marbles. Can't steal the earth beneath my feet. And is my head in the clouds, my naked legs left dangling. I can feel my heart begin to pound. And everybody saying something calling me. Something calling me. Something's calling me. A little bit deeper than I've ever been before. Long dark night, my soul it wanders. Can't see the light that moves me. If God is everything and everywhere that I belong, Spirit gently wakes me from my sleep. And so I say, something's calling me. Something's calling me. Something's calling me. A little bit deeper than I've ever been before. Oh Lord. Oh Lord. Take me deeper than I've ever been. Compassion's calling me a little bit deeper than I've ever been before. My faith keeps calling me a little bit deeper than I've ever been before. Peace is calling me a little bit deeper than I've ever been before. God is calling me, and I'm grateful like I've never been before.
awesome. Thanks, guys. By the way, that in the middle was Melvin Macias. And this over here was Michael Meacham. And so it's Justin Vogel and Yeah. Nice, huh? Wowee. That's awesome. Just a little something that came to me. Reverend Connie, would you like to come up and talk about this afternoon?
Okay.
Yeah. Did you know you were going to do that?
No.
Oh. Well, Michelle said you were. So this is about the luncheon.
I did say plug it, but I was thinking, well, you asked me to speak, and I forgot to plug it. So
plug.
There you go. Thank you for another opportunity. We invite you all to come and join us this afternoon. I know Michelle Taylor, the spearhead of the Global Outreach Group here, has got an awesome menu planned for you of Mexican food. So we invite you to come over and eat with us and listen to me talk again. I'm going to be talking more about my personal journey in Africa and the work that I'm doing, the projects that we're supporting, and how you can become more personally involved in that journey of what we're doing. The work that we're doing, as I said before, is absolutely, we have a vision in the Centers for Spiritual Living. The vision is to touch and transform 100 million lives. Well, I believe that in order to do that, we need to be where people live. We are Centers for Spiritual Living, that we need to be where people live. Where else to be than in a country with 45 million people in it? So I am in the middle of where they live. I teach science of mind principles in a slum school in Nairobi, Africa. So I am using this teaching in the heart of where people are living. And I invite you to come out and hear more about that and what we're doing. And thank you again for your support.
Thank you, Reverend Connie. Yeah, you can get tickets right inside the Great Room door, or they might be outside, I'm not sure where they are. But $10 for adults, children under 12 are $5. It's wonderful, and we'll hear some wonderful news as well. In 2 weeks from today, this center is going to host the Interfaith Forum. It's the kickoff of the series, so it's the first night. And so in that, on the 19th, it's interesting because Reverend Connie has the opportunity in her discovery class to talk about what is God, what do we believe about God. Well, that's the topic that first night. What does our faith believe about God? I get to present that. Piece of cake. Yay. I don't have to be nervous or anything this time. I will be, but I don't have to be. So Sunday, the 19th at 7 p.m., we'll have a little reception afterwards. It's a wonderful experience of about 6 sessions in different faith communities around town, hearing about individual faiths. The idea from the Interfaith Council of Southern Nevada is that this is a big part of their vision and mission is to build bridges of understanding. Let's understand where we all are. And we don't proselytize, we don't try to convert people, we just explain, this is what we believe, this is who we are. And it's a wonderful education and togetherness kind of experience. So that's just in a couple weeks, and there are flyers in the lobby that you can find out how all of the different places we're gonna be and the topics that we're gonna cover. And finally, it's already gonna be here next Saturday. So we have a wonderful presentation for you about Uncle Frankie and his malt shop. And I think they're ready. So this is going to be fabulous. I can't wait.
We're having a big shindig over on the Great Room. Over in the Great Room, October 4th, 3 p.m. to 6 p.m., Frankie's Malt Shop Social. A flash from the past. We're celebrating the 50s with malt shop favorites. There will be music, dancing, entertainment, and games and prizes. games and prizes. Mary, she's our host for the paddleball contest. And we have special guests. We have special guests for our photo opportunities. We have Elvis Presley. He's going to be here doing a little number for us. And we have Marilyn. She's going to be here also. So show up in your favorite 50s look, or come as you are. Tickets are $20, sold in the bookstore, or in the great room, or outside the great room, actually. Net proceeds will go to the sanctuary remodel. So all we do is ask you to buy a ticket, show up, participate, have a lot of fun. Okay? I can't hear you. All right, Mary, sit down. Mary. She's a pro. Thank you.
Thank you, Frankie. I keep calling you Uncle Frankie. I love the hair. That's awesome. Mary is so talented at that. She doesn't usually stop twice. I was going to have you walk back to your seat doing that. That would have been fun. Just don't start it during the prayer. Don't start it up during the prayer again, though. Okay. So there's so much going on. There's so much going on to get involved with. There's flyers around. There's, of course, our website. If you would like prayer when we finish, we're coming to the end of service now. If you'd like one-on-one prayer, I invite you to come to the front of the room. Our practitioners will be here with their stoles on at the stairs here, at the steps here, or across the patio in the prayer room. Join us for the luncheon. It starts around noonish, probably maybe a little earlier than that. And just so many wonderful ways to experience grace. And one of those ways is through prayer. So we're going to move into that time now as we close our service. We pray in a way that is so affirmative and it is so powerful. And we have a ministry of prayer that serves this center on a daily basis. They're going to stand now and surround this space with their presence. Every single day, our ministry of prayer, which are ministers and practitioners who serve here, we are committed to pray. We are committed to know the truth. We are committed to do affirmative prayer for you and this congregation every single day. If you have a specific prayer request, you can write that the next time you have a connection card. There's forms in the lobby. You can write an email to the Ministry of Prayer. We do address specific requests as well. But in general, we are aware that you are immersed in the presence of God, and we are affirming that on your behalf every single day. So with that awareness, I invite you to take in a deep breath, to let it out, to let your eyes close when that feels appropriate, and to allow the words of this song and then the words of the prayer and the silence in between the words to take you to that place of absolute recognition and acceptance that God is right where you are, right here and right now.
I am that I am. I am that I am. I am that I am. I am. I am. I am that I am. Yeah. I am that I am. I am that I am. I am. I am.
I am. I am the I am that God is. And what is God? God is everything and nothing. God is all there is. In the beginning, God created. In the beginning, God already is. Transcendent of time and space, existing before time or space was ever created. There was God and nothing. And then suddenly the universe. Where could it have come from but within that one that is God? created from the very substance of that one, which is outside of time and space and yet fills this moment, this place, right now. It is the truth everywhere, always. And it does not matter our experience, our belief, our awareness, or our acceptance. It is the truth. And I am so grateful to know that. That God is all that there is, therefore God is all that I am. There is nothing about me that is not that one in form and expression. And so I expand my awareness right here and right now to accept that truth for myself, for each one present, for all who are hearing, observing, or ever know these words. This is the truth of all creation. So I stand in that awareness right here and right now, knowing that the grace of God suffices in my life. It provides for every need. It leads the way. It fulfills my visions and dreams, and it supplies every need. And it happens through my own awareness. And so I declare my readiness right here and right now to be accepting and embracing of that higher truth, to know it for myself, for my family, for my community, for this Center for Spiritual Living Greater Las Vegas, for all centers for spiritual living worldwide, for all houses of worship, for all people, for all nations. This is the truth. I stand in this awareness. I allow grace to be my reality, and I surrender to it, and I know that it is very, very good.
And I know that within that mind that is God, that mind is your mind, that mind is my mind, that mind is all that is, because that mind is the mind that is living itself just for the joy of it. As we step out into life in a bigger way, I know that we are absolutely guided, guarded, supported, sustained, and maintained in every good way. I know that every step that I take is guided and guarded by the mind of God. I know that every breath that I take is the breath of God. I know that every thought that I think is the thought of God, because I know that God is all there is. And so I know that is true for each one of us, that we open up to a bigger idea of that mind moving through us, as us, being us, as we step out into our lives today, as we move forward, knowing that we are falling into the arms of God, knowing that grace is all there is, knowing that everything is already perfect. Knowing that this life is good because there's only one life. That life is God's life. That life is perfect. That life is my life now. Grateful for this life. Grateful for this center. Grateful for Reverend Doug and his expansive awareness of this life. Grateful for every practitioner that is here holding this beautiful consciousness. Grateful for every person that shows up to be the best they can be. I say thank you, God, for all of that. Thank you, God, for this beautiful day that is unfolding in perfect grace, right action, right knowing, right being. So I just let my word go into the law, because I know that my word is law. And I know that it is already done. So I accept it. I allow it. I live it. I am it. And together we say, and so it is.
I am letting go the things that no longer serve me. As I'm letting go, God's revealed and I am whole. I am letting go of the things that no longer serve me. As I'm letting go, God's revealed and I am whole. I am letting finish the day by singing I Release.
I release and I let go. I let the Spirit run my life.
Reach out, grab a hand on either side of you, across the aisle. Please say after me, something wonderful is happening in me right now. It is this thing called grace. Grace is in my mind. Grace is in my body. Grace flows through everything I do. I am it. I receive it. I share it. And I accept it. Just the way that it is, and just the way that it becomes. Thank you, life. Amen.